Mm-hmm. Poor Joyce. Try not to breathe this way, would you, darling?
You should have stayed in bed, Joyce.
I'm all right, thank you, Bernard.
No, I mean, during the show, you were crap.
Pay no attention to him, Joyce. It's just his infantile sense of humour.
Well, that's the boiler well and truly buggered.
What? You mean we've got to endure these ridiculous temperatures all evening?
No, it'll get worse in here. Here we are.
Oh, you've got it?
Last copy. Bloody hell. Get the heating on, Bernard. It's not working. Oh, what now?
Oh, Bernard's given the boiler a thorough technical inspection and apparently it's buggered.
With a capital F.
Can't you fix it, Bernard?
No.
You fixed it last time.
Last time, it wasn't buggered. What was it then? Knackered. What's the difference? Knackered's fixable, buggered's not. So what'll it take to fix it then? A plumber and a new boiler. You need money? Lots of it. How much have we got in the heating budget, Joyce?
Joyce isn't at all well, Gordon. She shouldn't even be here in these Antarctic conditions.
With a cough like mine, I'm not surprised. I'm sorry to hear that, Joyce. How much have we got in the heating budget?
Gordon.
A general maintenance budget, then?
We haven't got a general maintenance budget, Gordon.
Yes, we have. We agreed to set aside 10% of show profits to go to general hall maintenance.
When did we agree that?
At the last committee meeting, Joyce.
I wasn't at the last committee meeting, Margaret.
Oh, that's right. Clash with your Pilates.
Life must go on, Joyce. Pilates or no Pilates. We'll all be suffering from Pilates if we don't get something since.
You can afford me.
Yeah.
Joyce, it's my job to write the minutes.
Well, there you go then. You could have written the minutes and I read them. Let's not get bogged down in details, Joyce. That's what we agreed and that is what we will do. So all I need to know right now is, based on 10% of show profits, how much would we have in the heating budget if we had one now?
I shall have to consult my records, Gordon.
Do that, Joyce. Just take the naught off, Joyce.
I know how to do 10%, Gordon.
Of course you do.
Of final show profits?
Yes.
Including
everything. Flashing lights, just no heat.
Are you telling me that we only made £40 profit from the last show?
40?
Take the note off, Joyce.
Oh.
You had it on, didn't you?
I was trying to get it in my head, Gordon.
Fatal error. There's no room in there. You should have used the calculator. So our profit from the last show was...
Forty p.
40p. So our profit for the last quarter turned to heating is 4p, Bernard. What can you do with that then?
You do want me to answer that.
Oh, well, never mind. This'll warm the cockles of our hearts. The review. Little Grimley players show what they're capable of, written by Simon DuPont.
Ooh, I like the sound of him.
This weekend, I attended Little Grimley players' production of Death in the Toilet, a new play penned by the Society's chairman, Gordon Ramsbottom. It was...
Gordon, that's you.
Yes, Joyce, I know. It was billed as a murder mystery, which proved quite appropriate, as it was absolute murder to watch and remained a total mystery throughout. Usually in my reviews, I like to offer some in-depth analysis of both the play and the acting, but in this case, I can see that the point in bothering. If there was a plot, it eluded me. If there were any actors, I didn't spot them. The stagecraft was quite appalling throughout. The set was lamentable, wobbling so violently that I thought it would fall over. Indeed, at one point, I hoped that it would, so it adds some much-needed drama to the evening. The audio cues were either of excruciatingly poor quality or timed so badly as to be meaningless. On one occasion, a doorbell sound effect was cued so late that the actor had already entered the room. The only consolation I can find in the whole wretched affair is the fact that, as far as I could ascertain, none of my fellow citizens have been persuaded to attend this fiasco, and that there may be less long-term psychological damage to our village as a result. All in all, this is quite the most inane and putrid theatrical production I have ever had the misfortune to witness in all my years as a drama critic. My advice is to avoid it as you would the Black Death, to treat it with the same contempt as you would a pile of radioactive rat droppings. And should the deluded thespians of Little Grimley ever have the nerve to stage any future aberrations, I for one will not be there to witness the carnage.
Well, we've had worse reviews.
Have we?
The last production.
Oh God, don't take me there. My therapist has spent months trying to erase the scars.
Well, I'm disappointed.
That's just because you're too forgivable, Joyce.
I mean, what gives him the right to criticise?
He's a critic, Joyce.
Even so, such nasty comments doesn't he realise we're only amateurs?
Yes, I think he spotted that.
And look, the last comment, he didn't even bother to print the box office number.
Oh, pity anybody reading this would have been left frustrated not knowing who to ring to buy tickets.
Well, I'm glad I bothered. Do you realise this cost 8 times more than our heating budget?
But you always set fire to it.
What do the British always do in a crisis?
That's the most sensible thing you've said all night.
A nice cup of tea all round, Joyce. Thank you. He didn't have much option, did he, Margaret?
Oh, I don't know. We give him a choice of 4 bad nights.
Don't exaggerate, Bernard.
What, did you find one?
I think, considering the problems that we had during the dress rehearsal, that the opening night was outstanding.
That's literally true, Margaret. It certainly stood out, but just not in the way I would have liked.
What do you mean?
Well, it didn't exactly get off to a blistering start, did it?
Oh, do you stop keep harping on about that, Gordon? It was a simple fluff. These things happen in live theatre.
What's she on about?
Of course, Bernard. You wouldn't know about this, would you? I believe you were prompting that night?
So?
So, I'm on stage, the curtain's open, in bursts Margaret to deliver her opening line, and starts clicking her fingers for a prompt.
On her opening line?
A prompt which never came, Bernard, because you're outside having a crafty fag.
Well, I didn't think she needed me on her opening bloody line, did I? I thought she might have struggled onto page two before calling in the cavalry.
Do you by any chance recall Margaret's opening line, Bernard?
Yes, it was. Hello!
Hello! Hardly the most demanding opening gambit, is it? Not exactly the soliloquy from Hamlet.
Well, it's all very well mocking, Gordon.
Oh, good!
You didn't exactly leap to my rescue, did you? Theatre is about teamwork, you know?
Well, I do recall my opening line, Margaret. It was, "You talk to me, love." So you can see my dilemma. I could hardly say that before you'd say it.
I was under severe stress that evening. I had a lot of things going on in my mind.
Pity one of them wasn't your opening word.
So imagine the scene, Bernard. Leading lady on stage, clicking furiously for a prompt. Prompt outside, having a fag break. Leading man standing there looking like a prune, waiting to be spoken to. Stalemate. Thus passed the longest 7 minutes. I mean, I would have settled for anything, Margaret. I would have done it. No, nothing but more and more frantic people. Half the audience thought you were some kind of demented flamingo dancer.
Such a drama king, Gordon. I doubt the audience even noticed.
One of them called for an ambulance.
Well, he was an idiot.
He was a doctor. He thought you were having a seizure.
Looks like I missed all the fun there, then.
Yes, Bernard, and that's when you decided to join us.
Just in the nick of time, by the sound of it.
And prompt us into the middle of page six. Thus missing out the entire description of Margaret's background, her character, who I was, what we were doing there, indeed the actual murder itself, leaving the entire audience completely bewildered and clueless as to what they were doing for the rest of the evening.
No change there, then.
You made me look a fool, Bert.
No, you managed to do that all by yourself, Joyce. A prompt is only supposed to be there in cases of emergency.
This was an emergency, and you weren't there.
You should have learned your lines then, shouldn't you?
You don't understand, do you? You don't know what it's like to be a leading lady.
That's true.
The pressure is enormous, and the weight of expectation on my shoulders.
I had all quite a weight too. 7 minutes!
We got through it, didn't we? The rest of the evening went without a hitch.
Really? I watched back the video, Margaret.
Oh, God.
Well, you know how I like my post-match stats. Margaret, you took 174 prompts that evening. That's nearly one per sentence. We may as well have put Gordon in a dress and had him read your parts.
I have been under a lot of stress at home lately, Gordon. As well you know. I thought my team members here might have been able to offer me just a little more comfort and support.
What's up, Margaret? Your husband's still shagging that secretary.
Margaret, please.
Gordon, I'm outraged.
Well, don't be.
I told you about that very difficult, very personal life crisis in complete confidence.
I know.
How dare you blab to Bernard of all people?
I didn't, I promise. But what neither of us knew at the time is that he was still sat in his prompt seat.
What?
I'm afraid he overheard the whole thing.
Well, what the hell was Bernard doing in his prompt seat? He's never in his prompt seat.
Not when you need him, no. I'm afraid Don't worry. I spoke to him, and he said he's not going to say a thing, but you know what he's like.
Excellent. So now I'm the laughing stock of the whole society.
Don't worry. On a private word with him, I'll at least make sure that he doesn't tell Joyce.
Bernard, tell me Brian's been cheating on you again.
Again? What do you mean again?
I'm sorry, Margaret. We all thought it had stopped.
You all thought? What do you mean, stopped?
Well, let's just give Margaret some space, shall we? She needs our total support right now.
Have a nice warm cup of tea, Margaret.
Here you are, four mugs.
You can say that again.
That one's yours, Margaret, the one with the lipstick on the collar. Sorry, on the rim.
One of these days.
What?
You two, just play nicely.
Did I miss anything?
No, we were just discussing the merits of the last performance.
And?
Like I said, you didn't miss anything.
Listen, everyone, pay attention. Margaret has kindly agreed to remain in the premises, providing there are no further intrusions into her private life, either explicit or implicit. Is that clear, Bernard?
Yep.
Joyce?
What does implicit mean?
The opposite of explicit.
What does explicit mean?
The opposite of implicit.
What it means, Joyce, is the next person to upset Margaret will get finding his membership. Clear?
Perfectly.
Good. So, where were we?
We were discussing the sparkling review of our last production by the Journal's new theatre critic, Simon the Ponce.
And I suggested, and still maintain, that he just came on an off night. I mean, which night did he come anyway?
Saturday.
Well, there you go then. My point proven. There was absolutely no audience atmosphere that night.
There was absolutely no audience that night.
No, that's not true. There was that funny little man with the moustache and the briefcase and the... That must have been him!
Are you trying to tell me that the only person who came on a Saturday night had a free ticket?
It would appear so.
Bloody cheek.
Well, that's the last time we offer media VIP access to one of our shows.
They'll be gutted.
I don't understand.
No, we know, Joyce. Anyway, moving on to IP2.
Saturday night. Now we're lucky to get one person.
Oh, that look.
Thursday night was packed to the gills.
There are eight on Thursday, Joyce.
No, it was busier than that, Gordon.
It looked busier than that, Joyce, because all your friends were here serving their mince pies.
Oh yes, the WI ladies. Weren't they brilliant?
Yes, they were, Joyce. All 28 of them. The other 3.5 waitresses per customer. There was no queuing that night, I can tell you.
The waitress had to queue to serve the customers?
Well, my friend Ross said it was the best night he'd ever had.
Really?
Oh yes, he loves mince pies.
And did he enjoy the show?
He loves mince pies.
Well, here are the final stats. Wednesday, we had 4 prepaid, 1 on the door. On Thursday, there were 8 prepaid, none on the door. Friday, 5 prepaid, 3 of whom we turned up to cancel. And on Saturday, 1 complimentary. Except he wasn't.
What?
Very complimentary. He's slated as the Helen Mack.
So, if he didn't come until Saturday, you can't blame the review for telling you where the audience is.
An astute observation, Bernard.
So what has happened to Saturday nights?
Isn't it obvious, Joyce?
No.
Gordon, remember, Nothing is obvious to Joyce.
She's not well.
What's happened to Saturday nights, quite simply, is strictly an X Factor.
And Dancing on Ice.
What are they?
Joyce, what planet are you from?
What do you mean?
Don't you watch television on Saturday evenings, Joyce?
No, we don't have a television, Margaret.
What?
Me and Trevor decided it was killing the art of conversation, so we got rid of it.
Bloody hell!
So, what do you do at night?
We talk to each other.
Oh, a sod!
You're heading for a membership fine.
You said the next person to upset Margaret. You never said anything about Joyce.
And now I'm extending the rule to include Joyce. The next person to upset either of you two ladies will get a 15 quid fine.
You sure about that,
Walter?
Fair enough.
Thank you, Gordon.
So, Joyce, you may not have seen these television programmes, but I can assure you that most normal people do have a television.
Two televisions?
Three, actually.
And so Saturday nights now are all about Strictly and X Factor. Consequently, no one wants to leave their settee.
Pathetic. Don't they have a Sky Plus box?
They want to watch it live, Margaret. And it's not just us as affected. I've spoken to lots of societies who offer some quite decent alternative entertainment for people. And even they're struggling.
We're all doomed.
Not quite, Bernard. We've faced challenges like this before, remember? And survived.
Oh, crap. Gordon's had another idea.
And have my ideas in the past not been our salvation?
What have you written, Gordon?
Who said I've written anything?
I've heard you talk like this before. It's always a precursor to some new play of yours.
No new play, Margaret.
A panto?
Nope.
Musical?
No musical, Joyce.
Not then.
A show.
What kind of show?
A Saturday night show.
Go on.
You'd like to see the poster? Well?
Little Grimley proudly presents, live on stage, Strictly's X Factor on Ice.
Genius, eh? What do you reckon? This is finally our chance to compete with them head on. All the big Saturday night blockbusters roll into one.
So, what exactly is this?
It's a sort of singing and dancing competition with judges on ice.
Done by us.
Done by us, Margaret.
Call me a stickler for detail, Gordon. But where do we stage this extravaganza?
Right here.
Right. Well, set apart the fact that we've got no singers.
Or dancers.
Or judges, there's also the small matter of having no ice.
Oh. If we have ice, Bernard, I always keep the bar well stocked.
Oh.
You really don't have a TV, do you, Joyce?
What do you mean?
Friends and colleagues, please. Do you really have so little faith in your chairman?
Yes.
Thank you. But you should know by now, after all this time, that I always think through my ideas in the microscopic detail before I present it to committee.
Oh, looking forward to hearing this one.
We could always flood the stage and wait till January.
We will not need ice, Bernard, because we shall use these!
You're not serious.
Deadly.
Roller skates?
Exactly. And a perfectly good precedent. I presume you've all heard of the smash hit Andrew Lloyd Webber musical, Starlight Express?
Oh yes, Gordon. Trevor took me to see that in the West End.
Well then, as you can testify, Joyce, all the actors performed on roller skates.
Did they?
Yes, Joyce.
Oh, so that's how they did it.
So
when you say on ice, you mean on wheels.
Artistic interpretation.
Strictly's X Factor on wheels doesn't quite tell
us. Exactly. It's just a marketing ploy. Whatever it takes to get bums on seats.
I'm sure they didn't.
Didn't what, Joyce?
Had roller skates.
I assure you they did.
No, I'm sure I would have noticed.
This was the West End.
Yeah?
The West End of London? Not the West End of somewhere else?
Which theatre was it, Joyce?
It was the New London Theatre. Where's that?
London, Joyce? There's a clue in the name.
Well, there you go then. But I'm sure they did have roller skates on.
Yes, they did, Joyce. Anyway, can we hear that?
It wouldn't make sense.
Why not?
That's not really
how cats move. Cats!
Are you going to have the wrong musical there? Starlight Express doesn't have any cats in it.
Well, what's all with cats called
there? Cats, Joyce.
Oh, yes, that's the one. But I'm sure they didn't have roller skates.
No, they wouldn't have, would they, Joyce?
Then why did you say they did?
I didn't!
15 quid!
Look, can we talk about this when you're... well?
They have tapes.
Who did?
The actors.
Like, that's Joyce.
Can we move on? How so, Margaret?
Well, you're normally such a stickler for grammar.
And?
Strictly's X Factor. There should be an apostrophe before that S.
It doesn't say Strictly's X Factor.
Yes, it does. Look.
The penny drops. As I've said countless times before, Margaret, sex sells tickets. Little Grimley is taking the world's biggest shows and having the set factor! Bums on seats, Margaret! Well?
Well, what?
Will you finally put your faith in your chairman? Bernard?
I'm sure it'll be a roller coaster.
Good. Margaret?
You're not getting me on skates.
I have far higher aspirations for you, Margaret.
Such as?
A seat on the judge's table.
Very well then.
Joyce?
I still don't see what this has got to do with cats.
£15, Joyce. I need a quiet word with you outside.
Before they ask us to pay the bill, and while we stand, to share.
Right. Everyone in a position? Okay, let's go for it. Ladies and gentlemen, nice to see you, to see you!
Nice!
Thank you! Such a warm reception! Welcome to Strictly Sex Factor and Ice. Yes, your Saturday night begins here!
The cassette player's bloody playing up.
We're going to have to be a lot slicker than this on the night.
Well, Barney, some new equipment then.
Cassette tapes are so last decade. We should be on iPod.
Oh, yeah. I'll borrow some from the maintenance budget and get one. Anyway, let's just keep it simple. Forget the music sting. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Strictly Sex Factor and Ice, the show that Bernard! Leave it!
Alright, alright, it's got a mind of its bloody own!
Ladies and gentlemen, it's time to introduce our first contestant. Singing and dancing and skating to Cliff Richard's summer holiday, please give a warm, Strictly Sex Factorized welcome to our very own Joyce! Joyce! You're on, Joyce!
Where's my music?
Where's Joyce's music?
I'm working on it!
Work faster!
Summer holiday, you said?
That's the one.
Oh, not anymore.
Sorry, just give her anything. Hang on, Joyce!
Like what?
Anything!
Nothing's marked! Nothing's marked!
We're just... Give her that one. We're just changing the music, Joyce.
What?
Just ad lib!
Oh, my God, no, no.
Straight to Vernon Rebel Hall.
Zero!
rip the ten in half.
Gordon, good. Stay there, Johnson. Seven!
Seven is out of a trillion!
You've got to give her some daughter encouragement, Bernard.
Why?
A Margaret Bustle!
It's worth every penny.
15 quid, come on.
Okay.
What, are you to pay?
Yep.
Really?
Yeah, we had a deal.
15 quid then.
Less what the kitty owes me for wood.
What wood?
For the roof.
That was 2 years ago.
Good job, I'm not charging interest then.
How much?
35 quid.
35 quid? Have you got a receipt?
I did that 2 years ago.
Joyce! Oh, hang on. Kitty owes you 35.
Yeah.
You owe 15. Joyce, has the kitty got 20 quid for Bernard?
No.
So tough.
But it would have if you paid your membership.
I paid!
You were a year behind.
Cough up, Gordon. Come on.
Thank you. There.
Ta?
It'll teach you.
Well, I've learned my lesson.
Where's Margaret? Margaret, please sit down.
I'm not staying.
Please stay, we can sort it all out.
How?
Yes, how?
I don't know. I'll find a plumber who can fix cassette tapes, but in the meantime, can we concentrate on the dress rehearsal?
Well, I thought we nailed it. I'll see you on opening night.
Vernon, come back. Look, I know it was a bit rough, but it was our first time through.
First? We've got to do all that again.
Well, that's the general principle. Any questions?
Yes, several. Where's their dance partner?
Partner?
Well, there's usually two of them.
It may have escaped your notice, Bernard, but we're slightly short-staffed tonight. That'll be a solo effort.
But doesn't that kind of defeat the whole point of the show?
No, it's X Factor as well. The audience has the singing to compensate.
I'm interested you said the word compensate.
And of course there's the sex factor.
Which is?
Missing. You can work on it. Maybe your more exotic, glittery costumes, something a bit more revealing.
You want to reveal more, Joyce?
What's he saying about me?
Nothing, Joyce. Any more stupid questions?
Yes. Is that it?
What do you mean, is that it?
Well, it seemed a bit short.
So we only saw one act.
But exactly. Then what?
Then we could wheel Joyce around behind the judge's table. One of you two could strap on her roller skates while I pad for a bit as a presenter.
Gordon, we need to talk.
Talk?
Alone?
Bernard, take a break.
Suits me. I'll try and sort this out.
And wheel Joyce off, will you please?
Come on, Joyce.
What is it?
Let's have a bit of fresh air.
You mean a cigarette?
Ah, same thing.
I didn't want to compromise your authority in front of the other team members, Gordon.
Very thoughtful of you, Margaret.
After all, you are our chairman, our leader.
Margaret, I know you too well. This is the sycophantic preamble you usually give me just before verbally kicking me between the legs. So get on with it.
This isn't working.
Which bit?
All of it!
You noticed?
Dancing on Ice, Strictly, X Factor. Really, Gordon? Not only are they high-budget, slick productions, but they're great British institutions. You can't just rape and pillage them like this. Our audiences would never forgive us.
Once again?
Look, I know you mean well, dear, but...
There's no need to go on, Margaret. You're right. I've known it all along. You know, everything I've ever done here has been for the greater good of this society. Little Grimley ADS means a lot to me. God knows I fought tooth and nail to keep this venerable institution going, through good times and bad. I mean, mainly bad. But somehow, no matter what the odds, we've always found a way, the Little Grimley way. But this time, I fear we've bitten off more than we can chew. We can no longer push back the sands of time, Margaret. We have to face the facts. There's no place for us in the modern world. This production was my final brave attempt to compete, to survive. But I know that ultimately, all I'm doing is setting us up for another savage kicking in the press. And that's not fair to you, Margaret. It's not fair to any of you. I really fear it's the end this time. It's a sad day. Inevitable one. I'll tell the others. And Bernard,
I've got away
taking the piss. So I hear. Go and get Joyce, will you? I have an important announcement to make.
Wait! I said it wasn't working. I didn't say it couldn't work.
What do you mean?
Well, certain elements did show promise.
What elements?
Well, I thought I was quite good as a judge.
Go on.
And Joyce's act was, if nothing else, entertaining.
In what way?
Amusing.
Did you think so?
You didn't.
I was wetting myself.
You didn't show it?
Ever pro, Bernard?
Well, that's one of the positives, Gordon. Though it pains me to say it, you were, well, actually quite good.
Yeah. Thank you.
You weren't all that bad.
Well, Lord, praise is rolling in from all quarters.
As a presenter.
And as a judge.
That's one of the problems, Gordon. You cannot be both a presenter and a judge.
We need four judges, Margaret. We already have one dummy on the panel.
No, leave Bernard out of this.
Boy.
Be nice to Bernard, Margaret.
You can't fire a year's membership if we disband, can you? So I might as well fill me boots.
Be nice to Margaret, Bernard, because Margaret has an idea.
I'm listening.
Well, watching Joyce gave me the thought. Why should we provide all the entertainment when we can get somebody to do it for us?
Meaning?
We let Joyce go on first, lead the way, set the tone, then in true spirit of X Factor karaoke auditions, we invite the general public on stage to show us their talent.
What if they haven't got any?
Even better. There's nothing the great British public like watching more than talent, and that's watching.
A bunch of deluded nonnes.
Margaret's right, that's the best bit of the X Factor.
Brilliant! So they're not judging us, they're judging each other.
Exactly. And then we make them suffer. The distinguished judges panel and the inevitable Mr. Nasty.
You mean Bernard?
No, no. Someone who commands far more respect.
Don't push it.
Someone far more eloquent, far more vicious. Somebody who could cut you down with his tongue with consummate ease.
Do what?
Use words of more than one syllable.
And where do we find such a... Simon DuPont?
Keep your friends close, but your enemies closer.
That's inspired. Think you'll go for it?
What, with an ego like that? A chance to slag off everyone in front of a packed audience, with him sent to stage as the star of the show? How can he resist?
But would it be a packed audience?
With Simon DuPont promoted every week in the local rag? Of course it will.
Genius!
We could afford an iPod.
And stop
them. Oh, there'll be glamour.
A moonlight.
And music.
And
tight sequins, sexy costumes.
And glittery balls.
What?
Mirror balls, we've got to have those.
All right. Well, that's it. Excuse me. Well, that's it then! Strictly Sex Factor and ice! It's no longer an ice! It's firmly on the front burner!
Oh, I can't wait to tell Joyce! Joyce!
Do you know, I don't remember the last time I saw Margaret so excited.
Oh, yes, you can. But you made me promise not to bring it up!
Shh! Bernard? Where's Joyce?
Don't know.
Well, where did you leave her?
We were outside having a fag in there, and then... Oh, shit!
I've got a bad feeling about this.
Oh, God.
I'd better go.
No, let Bernard go, he's the fastest runner.
Oh, we should do this.
She's not answering her phone.
She might have other priorities right now.
Bloody fag breaks! It even says on the packet, smoking can kill!
I don't think that's what they had in mind.
Yeah. It comes! Everything will be fine! There's nothing we can do about it. Let's do something positive. Keep our minds occupied.
Like what?
I'll ring Simon DuPont to sell him the concept.
You have his number?
Of course. Who do you think invited him to the show?
Excellent.
Well, it may just turn out to be that way. No, he's not answering either. Shall I leave a message?
You better not. He might scrub it before you get to the punchline. Wait till you can talk to him in person.
Bernard!
Don't panic.
Well?
Well, you know, Joyce wasn't feeling very well.
Yes?
Well, she's just gone downhill fast.
Bloody hell, she hurt.
By some miracle, no. But...
But what?
Best she tell you herself.
Bernard had promptly had to get to the lamppost outside, and I went to come in and reach for the door handle and...
That's a very steep hill, Joyce. I'm amazed you weren't injured.
Oh, I would have been if that jogger hadn't have caught up for me. Too late for the motorist, though.
Motorist?
He swerved to avoid hitting me and went straight into the butcher's window.
Oh, God, is he all right?
He smashed ribs. Damaged kidneys, squashed loins, and the sausages were a total write-off.
What about the driver?
Just hurt his pride, I think. The car looked a proper mess, though.
This is all you're doing, Bernard!
Oh, don't blame Bernard, Margaret. I haven't told you the best bit yet. He did us all a favour.
How so, Joyce?
I recognised the driver from his photo.
Photo?
Yes, he was that critic man who slagged us off. Looks like we got our own back, eh?
Oh.
Where are you going?
The pub, Joyce. The pub.
I thought they'd be pleased.
Oh, you know those two, never grateful.
So did I miss anything exciting?
No, Joyce, nothing. You going for a drink?
Normally I'd say no, but I think a small sherry might, you know, help steady my nerves.
It's on me. Come on, I'll get you out of those things. Joyce? That driver?
What about him?
Do you think he recognised you?
Couldn't have done. I was travelling backwards.
So, he didn't see your face?
No, I only clocked it was him when you were pulling me back up the hill.
Then there might be a chance.
Of what?
Look, I'll tell you later. I've got to tell the others.
Bernard, no.
Stay there. I'll be back in a sec.
Bernard.
Okay?
Bernard!